Good afternoon, everyone. I hope we didn't keep you waiting too long, basically getting set up. Thanks for joining again. This is the fifth and last part of this webinar series, which we've been doing over the last 5 weeks. It's been very interesting for us, and we've been happy that a lot of people seem to be joining and benefiting from it. Thank you for your messages and your feedback also. I'm Karan. And Yogita is with us too. And basically, we are from Green Essentials. We are based out of Goa. And we will take you through this session, which I think is sort of coming to the part where you will end up in a couple of weeks or so. The session, of course, is not possible without our friends at Asgeek, who've been helping us, you know, do all the technology bits to make sure things are working well. They've also been helping us moderate the session and making it easy for us to understand what your questions are and answer them. So thanks a lot to all of them. Green Essentials is something we started back in 2009, but it happened after we originally started growing in 2006 or so. And basically, we've been growing for the last 14 years at home. We started growing using organic methods, and that's what we've stuck to because it's worked well for us so far. We have a kitchen garden store, which is in Goa, just outside one of the towns in Goa. We do these workshops, or have been doing workshops, for about 10 years now, since 2010. And we've been trying to make it simpler for people to learn how to grow. We have also done, I guess, what you would call small scale farming, because we've grown vegetables and fruits and herbs of a scale of up to about 1.5 hectares at its peak. We're not doing it presently because we are looking for a new space, but I mean, that was an adventure that I guess we can talk about in a different situation. And then one of the things that we do also is to actually coach new kitchen gardeners, helping them learn how to grow their own food and sort of hand-holding them through the process. So, you know, the starting point of our presumption has always been, and this is probably going to be interesting to a lot of you who live in apartments, we actually started by growing in pots. We did not really grow in the ground until later on, maybe the second year or so of our growing learnings with growing. So we found eventually, and if you would ask me to compare now, that growing in pots is, in a sense, many senses easier, and certainly it can be very productive. What you're seeing here is a bunch of basil plants lined up, and you know, just two pots of basil is more than anybody else can consume. Just to recap what we did in session 4, which was probably our longest session of this series, since we were talking about pests and disease. So soil health is something we discussed in detail. How do we maintain soil health? We talked about how overwatering frequently causes problems in gardens, and you know, not in the least because it creates the environment for fungal diseases. Mulching is something that we really stressed. And as I said the other day, you know, if there is nothing you take away from these sessions, it is that you must mulch your soil if you want to make gardening easy for you. It has several benefits. And, you know, if you adopt it, I'm sure you will, you know, see that it is one of the most important things you can do in your garden. We also talked about how we design gardens to have diversity, even when we are growing in pots in a balcony on a terrace, because this provides protection against damage because of pests and disease. And then we talked about several preventive things and remedies that we could employ when we are faced with the pests occurring in the garden. So for those of you who weren't there for the last session, a lot of these are available to be viewed still online. And if you join the Telegram group, we'll share all the links over there for all the past sessions and, of course, the recording for this one. Now, this is the sort of structure that we've been following through the sessions. And in this particular edition, we'll cover harvesting of our produce, of vegetables especially. And, of course, something about how you plan for your next cycle of growing. Because When it comes to your kitchen garden, it is something that proceeds and evolves through the seasons and through the year. And while many of the activities that you will conduct will be similar from season to season, the things that you grow are likely to vary substantially. So this is what we'll talk about in the session that is just coming up. This session, here are the key points. When do you harvest? How do you know that something is ready to harvest? And how should you harvest to ensure that you get maximum produce from your vegetables? How do you plan your replacement or succession plan? So after one crop gets over, how do you make sure there is continuity, either in that pot or in the kind of food that you want to grow? How you can grow fruits, including fruit trees, in large containers, something that many of you may not have considered. You can actually, if you have enough space, have large pots growing pretty productive fruit trees in balconies and terraces also. And lastly, of course, we'll get to your question and answers about what we've covered. Just want to point out for those who are joining for the first time, if you have questions that you think up during the course of the session, you can enter them in the Q&A section of your Zoom interface. So most likely at the bottom of your screen, you will see the Q&A section. It's like two speech bubbles. You just click on that and you put your question in, and we will be able to add it to the list of things to be addressed, right? So please remember to do that. It creates a much more interactive kind of opportunity for all of us to make sure that we clarify the things that we've talked about. Now, harvests from kitchen gardens, depending on how many pots you are actually growing in, can be reasonably regular and substantial. And if you've done your planting in a way which is diverse, as you can see, this is just one day's produce from one of our kitchen gardens. And you get a lot of things there. You can see strawberry, you can see edible flowers from, gourds. You can see capsicum over there. You can see some kale, some karela, and brinjals and tomatoes and so on. So basil also. So diverse produce is actually achievable. I'd like to stress that every image that you see over here is pretty much from our gardens. We don't use images, other than that. So over the years, we've kind of ended up accumulating a lot of these, and that's what we are using here. So, Yogita used to say this from our first session, and we've titled these sessions to kind of reflect the same spirit. Her statement used to be at that time, maybe 10 years ago, she used to say, if Karan can do it, then anyone can. And we really believe that, each of us, if we decide that we want to and are willing to take a little bit of effort, then anyone can grow. So I'll pass it on to Yogita, who will take you through, some of the things that you need to keep in mind when you are harvesting your vegetables, or in terms of being able to judge when your vegetables are ready for harvest. Right. So over to Yogita.
Okay. Hi, everyone. So I'm going to talk about the different things that can be harvested. I have photos on the screen that you can follow, but I also have some things here which we can get to once we're done with the presentation. So, harvesting is really an important part, pretty much an important part of the health and the life of your plant. And what I mean by that is that several fruiting vegetables, especially like brinjals, like chilies and tomatoes and bhindi, if they are not harvested regularly and soon enough, then the plant gets a signal that my job is done. I have produced a fruit which has produced seed. Now I can well pack up for the season. So remember, when you get produce, like a lot of these fruiting vegetables, make sure you keep, even if you're not eating them, harvest it, give it to your neighbors, so that the plant continues to then put in more of its energy into producing new fruit. And that's one of the things that extends its life. So I'll go through some of the common crops that we would have chosen to grow and how we can tell whether something is ready or not. Corn is something that may not be very easy to grow in containers, but a large 12 to 14 inch pot, you could very well grow corn. And you have the stalk of corn, and between the stalk and you have the leaves coming out. So between that, the ear of the corn emerges. Once it emerges, you have the hair or the silken thread right up on the top. When the corn is still immature, that will be very soft and tender and green. And as it starts maturing, that hair starts becoming brown and it starts drying up. Usually, you know, from the time the hair emerges, it's about 15-20 days to harvesting, maybe 20 days to harvesting sweet corn where you want the kernels tender. If like me, you had tried popcorn, then of course you have to wait much longer. But a sure way to check that the kernels inside are ready is just open up the covering of the corn, go down to the kernels and poke it with a nail and see if a milky white liquid emerges, it means it's ready. Otherwise, if it's a clear liquid, then you still have maybe 3-4 days to go. So you don't have to pull it off the plant. You can just cover it back again and you can wait 2-3 days and you can then sort of go back and harvest it. So that's as far as corn goes. We have okra or bhindi, ladyfinger. This is something that we would plant a lot just now. And the sure way to tell bhindi is ready is, you know, when you are breaking it off the stem, it should actually snap easily. Or even if you're trying to cut it with a pair of scissors, it should come off easily. Because if it doesn't, it means the entire bhindi has become fibrous and sort of you can't really, it's become over mature. Even when we go to buy bhindi, normally we snap the top to see whether it's tender enough. And if it breaks with a quick, you know, a nice sounding snap, you know this is tender and it's fresh and it can be eaten. But if it doesn't and it just stays there and bends over, then of course the it has become over mature. So you don't end up buying that. Same thing when you're cutting it off, make sure that you basically, it comes off very easily. Now, with brinjal, how does one tell? Firstly, you should know the variety you are growing. What is the size? What is the shape? What is the color? Sometimes you have a white brinjal and you may wait for it to turn purple, but it won't turn purple because it's a white brinjal. So you must know what you have planted. Sometimes it's a long one and perhaps you're waiting for it to become a nice fat round one and it never will. So once you know your variety, the one on the screen that you see is a long purple variety. If you look at the skin, it's very nice and shiny. When it's shiny, it's firm to touch and you cannot feel that it's got seeds inside. If you just hold it gently in your hand and gently sort of press it, you'll feel that it is tender. If you feel that you can feel the seeds have become have gotten formed, then you know that it is past its prime. And with brinjal, it's better to err on the side of too early than too late because a brinjal that's too seedy is really no fun to eat. So it should be shiny, it should be firm, and of course, depending on your variety, you should know when it is more or less ready. It would take about maybe 3 months by the time you get to harvest your first brinjal from the time you plant. Moving on to the next vegetable, cucumbers. Again, with cucumbers, depending on what variety they are, it's better to harvest them when they are a little tender rather than when they become mature because the seeds develop inside and it becomes pithy. When you press the fruit, it should feel firm. If it feels a little soft and pithy, then you know that, again, it has sort of matured. So once your vegetables have started producing, it's a good idea to go and just keep a check on them, touch them, you know, feel them, and you will know the difference when you've harvested, you know, the first few. You will of course harvest some wrong, and that's a good thing because then you learn when not to harvest. So that's really what you do for cucumber. It should be firm, it should be tender to touch, and the next one. Chilies. Now chilies are interesting because different recipes ask for green chilies or red chilies, and you can actually harvest them pretty much at any cycle, at any stage in their cycle. The green ones tend to be a little more pungent, and as they become red, they lose a little bit of their heat. They tend to get a little sweeter. If you would like to save the seeds of a particular chili plant, then you must necessarily harvest it after it turns red. The green ones are immature. So in cooking or in food, the green ones to harvest are fine. The red ones also, you know, will be a little less hot, but the taste and the flavor will be there. And if you really want to harvest for the seed, then make sure you catch it only when it turns red. Tomatoes, again, there are different types of tomatoes. You have purple ones, you have yellow ones, you have pink ones, you have the regular red ones. They are cherries and they are table tomatoes. Of course, it helps when you know the variety, so you know what you're looking for. All tomatoes start out green, and when you see the first hint of color in them, you know, if it's supposed to be a yellow tomato or a red tomato, you'll see the first blush of color coming. That's the point where you can pick it and you can store it outside. Don't store it in the fridge, but you store it in a basket in your kitchen, and it will eventually completely turn to its final color. If you harvest, you can also choose to not harvest them and leave them on the plant. And I'll show you when I'm transplanting the last of the tomatoes, the cherry tomatoes is on it. You can choose to not harvest, and it can turn full color, like a full red, before you pick it up off the plant, and that would also be fine. But sometimes I like to be a little cautious, because you find either birds get to it, or you know, some other creature could get to it and it could get spoiled. So the minute I see a little bit of the color is on, I do end up taking them off as soon as then. Moving on to some of the herbs like basil. Basil is one of the herbs that the more you harvest, the bushier it gets and the more productive it becomes. Now the logic is that basil will grow as a single stalk, and at the point at the top of the plant, you will see four leaves come in the shape of a cross. Here is where you really need to pick the leaves. This is also the point where the flowers will start forming. So when you break it off at this point of where the four cross leaves are, you basically encourage more stems to grow and more branching to happen. And so the plant becomes really nice and bushy. And for each stem that you break the terminal leaves off, there will be more branching out at that end. What you should keep in mind is if you don't harvest them again, the plant will start flowering. And at that point, as soon as the plant starts flowering, the chemistry of the plant changes to the point where the leaves, they start tasting a lot sharper and a little pungent also. So the flavor changes, and especially the picture you see there is Italian basil. It has a lovely, fresh, tender taste that sort of matures and becomes a little overpowering. So to ensure that flavor continues, harvest regularly, give it away to someone, but make sure that you keep the harvesting process on. Okay, so this is applicable now to a bunch of leafy vegetables, whether they are mustard or it's spinach, or things like arugula or pak choy, lettuces. We start harvesting, I would say, about 45 days to 50 days after you've sown the seed. You try and go down to the lowest point where the leaf is attached to the main stem and just snap it gently with your hand. You don't really need scissors because they're very tender, and the leaf will come away. And you can harvest from each plant about, I won't say how many leaves you can harvest, I'll say how many leaves you should leave on the plant. So at any point, you should leave about 4 to 5 leaves on the plant so that they continue to grow and you can harvest the remaining. And that's true for pretty much all the leafy vegetables, that you leave about 4 to 5 plants leaves, and it will continue then to produce more. That's I think true for almost all of the leafy vegetables. Now cabbage is an interesting one. It's a winter crop in most places. It basically the leaves start forming, and at some point they start curling in and forming the head, which you see in the center of the screen. Now in the early stages you will see that there is the formation of the head, but when you touch it, it will be very soft. It will be spongy almost, and it'll feel like it's hollow or it's not a tight head. By the time it is fully ready and ready to be harvested, the ball becomes very firm to touch. It's almost like it's really hard, like a rock hard thing. And that firmness indicates that yes, it's now time to harvest. make sure that the plant, like some of the leaves can start cracking up. If you waited too long, you'll find that the top leaves have started cracking open, and that has been, then that indicates that you are late on your harvesting and you need to take it off. So you harvest it either by pulling out the plant entirely from the soil, you dust off the soil and just cut the part that's attached to the root, and you have your entire cabbage ready. So that's really what you do with the cabbage. Moving on to cauliflower or broccoli, again from the same family, they are also winter crops in most of the places that I've seen them grown. They require, I mean, places like Bangalore, you could grow them pretty much most of the year because your temperatures are cooler, but like around 20 degrees or so at night, thereabouts. Now, the broccoli and cauliflower that we eat are actually the unopened buds of the plant. So it's a cluster of flowers and they are tightly closed. If you wait too long, each of these individual buds start opening. You probably may not have seen a cauliflower or a broccoli that has flowered, but if it does, you'll see the little yellow flowers inside. And the minute you start seeing that, you know that you have that the plant has passed its prime. So there are different varieties of broccoli. The one you see here is what we call a sprouting broccoli. So you'll find several little florets. And as long as the buds are closed and tight and firm, it's good to go. And for many of these things, it's better to, like I said, err on the side of a little too early than a little too late. Because if it becomes fibrous or pitty or too seedy, then it sort of loses the flavor and the taste. And also, these vegetables are sweeter when they are harvested, when they are tender. Another thing which I should have mentioned when I was talking about the leaves is that for most, actually it's true for almost all vegetables, they are best harvested in the early morning or in the earlier part of the day because it's still cooler and a lot of the plant juices are freely flowing in the plant, and that's when it's really juicy, especially with leaves. If you go at about 11 o'clock or 12 o'clock in the afternoon, a lot of the moisture will have gone down to the roots and the plant leaves will be very limp. So if you're harvesting for a salad at about 11 o'clock or 12 o'clock in the heat of the sun, your leaves will look really limp. But if you harvest it in the morning, and you can either put it in a glass jar of water, and you can probably see it on my desk, but I'll show it again later when the camera comes to me. You can store it that way and it will stay fresh for up to a couple of days. So you don't have to worry about that. But harvest in the morning before the sun gets too high, and that's good for all your vegetables. Okay, moving on to the next one, beans. Beans, again, it varies by size and variety. So what you see are purple French beans. The way to tell when this is done is that you should not yet be able to see the outline of the seed inside this, which means that the seeds are still tender and soft. When you touch it, the pod feels nice and firm. You cannot distinguish the feel of the seed inside the pod. The minute you can do that, then you know that, again, the fruit has sort of ripened. And when you cook it, the seed will have a bite. You will feel the seed. You may enjoy that flavor. There's nothing wrong with it. But normally, we are used to having it when the seeds are still tender. If you wait a little too long, sometimes the seeds do become a little hard and chewy. And then you can't really use them in the vegetable. So try and catch it before that point too. Now, underground vegetables like radish and root vegetables like radishes, carrots, or bulbs like onions, you basically need to work your finger around the vegetable into the soil and go in for an inch or so, maybe even a couple of inches if you can go that deep. And you can actually tell by feeling around that the vegetable has formed, like the radish has formed. Now, radish is particularly a quick growing crop. Depending on varieties, it can be as early as 35 days and it can go on to maybe 40 days. So, 30, an average of 30, 35 days, you can be ready to harvest it. So, that's when you would poke around and check. Carrots, on the other hand, would be 4 months pretty much. And you again can pull out one or two and see, you will have a bunch of them. You can pull them out and see, or just work your finger in and you will know. Same thing for onions. Work your finger into the soil and you will get a feel of the vegetable inside. And when it's about the size you'd like it, you know, even onions, full-grown onions take about 4 months. Carrots take about 4 months. And radishes are really fast, like 35 to 40 days. So the other thing, especially about radish, and I think it's true even so for carrots, is that they tend to, when they're ready, they almost poke out of the soil. So if you have a long white radish, you will find that when it's ready, the top like inch or so is sticking out of the soil. It could also happen when the radish is not yet fully mature. So at that point, if it's poking out, you need to just take the soil and mound it around so that it's not visible to you anymore, the actual radish, only the leaves are. That's when it will develop well and it will be juicy. Otherwise, the top tends to dry out and become greenish, especially the white radishes. They become green and they don't taste very nice in that section. So as long as it's still growing, make sure the entire radish or carrot or onion is under the soil, not halfway up or whatever, sticking out. And when it's ready, you just pull the whole thing out. So back to Karan now. He talks more about succession planting.
Okay, so you'd have a sense now how harvesting is, done for all these different types of vegetables that we mentioned. There may be many that we've not covered, but, in general, I think these are enough to give you a sense. As Yogita said, that it's not a very exact science. You're not going to be very sure. And it is something that you have to develop the ability to get right. You don't want to be harvesting too late because everything becomes either chewy or not tasting as you want it to do. It's not tender like we usually like to eat them. And it's better to err on the earlier side, because quite often if you even harvest some of these things earlier than they usually are, you will find that that just means that they are a lot more tender, crunchy and sweeter than you're used to eating them. You know, an example I give to people is that, so we live in Goa and we are not really the best cabbage growing place in that sense. Cabbage likes cool weather. It would much prefer to be grown, for example, in Bangalore, right? But even though that is the case, when we have our cooler weather and do grow cabbages in our winter, we find that the cabbages that we harvest, because they harvested a little early, excuse me, they taste quite different from what we are used to in terms of the market cabbages. So question I frequently ask during workshops is, how exactly would you describe the taste of a cabbage? And most people will either say it's neutral or a little bit spicy. Now the cabbages when harvested young are actually sweet. So, and the difference is so pronounced that, you know, our daughter, for example, loves eating cauliflower and broccoli simply because she finds that when we harvest them young from the garden, her experience of them has been more on the sweeter, tender side, as opposed to very flat or neutral, or maybe even a little bit overdone when most people kind of source it from the market, right? So the difference is substantial, and therefore we are quite, clear about the fact that it's a better thing to harvest a little early. Now, once you've gone through your harvest, you have to immediately, there is a crop cycle for every plant. There's a period through which it grows. We've talked about it in the past, but there is a period of harvest, and then the harvest comes to an end. And what happens after that is a very important thing in the story of your garden through the year. So what we feel is that as a kitchen gardener using limited space at home, it is extremely important that we plan the successions or the next round of planting very carefully. And there are different ways to look at this, succession. So one way we look at it is where we say that the same vegetable, suppose this is something we want to source right through the year, 12 months of the year, we want to eat a particular vegetable. Say, for example, maybe spinach, being an example. So because we want a regular supply of spinach, we have to make sure that the new crop has not only grown, but reached its harvesting stage by the time the previous crop is petering out, right? So staggered planting is what achieves this outcome for us. The second thing is that, we may be growing the same vegetable, maybe a different variety, or maybe, at different maturity rates as the seasons change. And as a result, we have to plan for early, mid and late kind of season crops. So as an example, you may choose to have baby spinach, which is an early cycle crop, or you may decide that you like your spinach leaves a little bigger than the baby leaves, but not as big as the big ones because you're not cooking them, you're actually eating them raw. And in that case, you know, it will be a couple of weeks further along. Yeah, same for also spring onions, as Yogita said. So, I mean, if you harvest them as spring onions, obviously they are in the greens form. That's what you're using them for. Whereas later on, it is for the bulb largely because the leaves have usually died out, right? Correct. So, to reiterate, Yogita is just pointing out that certain varieties are just early and late varieties. So, you may say broccoli, but broccoli itself, there will be one variety which is ready in about 50, 60 days or so, and another that may be 85 days, right? So these are things that you have to kind of keep in mind when you're planting, and it's good to check these before you sow so that you know when the next succession needs to be timed. Sometimes successions involve actually fast and slow growing crops also. So the example Yogita gave of radish, which is ready extremely fast, it's 35, 40 days usually, it's ready. But then your pot will be empty in 35 or 40 days when you pull out the radish, and you should have planted the next kind of slower growing crop to replace it. For example, say a brinjal or a cucumber, something like that. Right. And the last thing is that in terms of successions, you also want to keep in mind the idea of crop rotations. Now, for those who haven't been in the previous, session, one of the things we recommend is not to grow the same things in the same pots in successive seasons. So let us say, for example, you grow tomato or brinjal, which are fairly heavy free feeders in your pots for this season. Then the rotation crop which comes in after this should be something different from these. And the idea is that, you know, it is because different plants require different proportions of nutrition. And if certain ones have been depleted already, then the next crop is not hampered by that because it requires a different set of nutrients. So you may replace something like tomato or brinjal with, say, beans, which actually add nitrogen back into the soil because they are leguminous plants and nitrogen fixers, right? So, and at the very least, even if you don't consider that, they have different nutrition needs and they will not be overly depleting the same things that were consumed in the previous season, right? So, now this, I mean, the next couple of slides require a little bit detail to explain, but hopefully, we should be able to understand the process very simply. Let's take the example of ladyfinger, which is one thing we've suggested you grow at this time of the year. We've suggested it because it not only grows well in the summer or the warm weather we're experiencing now, but say a month from now, or a little over a month from now, maybe 5 or 6 weeks, when the monsoon comes around, it continues to do well, right? So in the summer, the time taken for the growing stage of ladyfinger is approximately a couple of months. So as you see in this graph in front of you, through May and June, say for example, you would have the growing phase. And by July, these ladyfingers would be productive. Now, usually you can expect about 8 weeks of productivity out of the ladyfinger after this. It may be a little longer or a little less depending on the health of the plant and the conditions, climatic conditions. But that is what you would expect on average. So more or less by the end of August, you're reaching a stage where your ladyfinger is reaching the end of its productive period, right? So what we actually do is that we plant the succession. So you can see where it says #2 brinjal, #2 brinjal. That's your second round of brinjal, which replaces the ladyfinger. So you've gone from ladyfinger and then the succession in the same pot is the brinjal, right? And it will take this succession period, which is about 2 months, is how long the brinjal takes to grow before it's productive. And then if you can see after that, the productive phase is much longer. Here we are seeing it all the way through October, November, December, but could well go on till January and February too. Right. So basically at the beginning of August, which is the beginning of this succession period, is when you sow it in your nursery, and its transplant happens about a week later. So that, a month later, so that it can replace your existing brinjal plant, right? In that way, you are roughly, you're ensuring continuity of produce in that particular pot, starting with ladyfinger and moving on to the brinjal thereafter, right? So let's take a second example for the same thing. Now, the first this is a different pot. Let us say it is a, you know, about a 10 to 12 inch pot. And in that, the first round of what you will sow will be spinach or palak, right? So again, this has about a 2 month period during which it will grow. It will be at least about 50 days before I think you will be able to harvest, because it will be too young before that, right? And essentially 55 to 60 days, if you start harvesting, it can be kept productive for another couple of months still. Now, you know, Yogita referred to the fact that you will not be harvesting, pulling out the whole plant. You will be plucking a few leaves at a time, and therefore you need to have multiple pots. But this plant will continue to produce leaves every week for you to consume, and you can keep on harvesting bit by bit, thereby extending the productivity of that plant for a period of time, right? And then what do? We plan the succession. And in this case, we've suggested, say, long beans, right? And these can be grown in the same pot. The size of the pot is right. Again, about a month before you are coming to the end of your productivity cycle, you can put down the seeds, and you are in a position to sort of have them grow and be productive soon after the previous crop gets over, right? Now, you can make this even tighter. Like, you could actually put down the seeds a whole month earlier, and so that on that end of August date, you would have these productive bean plants rather than having them, you know, starting in the month of October, which is what I've shown over here, right? So you can stagger this to be as close together as you like. Sometimes we like to leave it a little bit apart, simply because, you know, you also want to change in what you're eating. So it gives you an opportunity to be eating other things while you have sort of a little bit got bored of beans. So it gives you a little gap, and, you know, then it's back for you to consume. The last example, and I'm giving you all three examples just to make it clearer for you, and these are examples of what you could actually do in your pots, is cucumber. So again, this has a little longer growing period. As you can see, it's about 2.5 months, and then it has a longer productive period too. It can be as much as 3-3.5 months of productivity from your cucumber plants if they continue to be healthy and continue to be cared for, right? So again, what we do is that a month before we expect this productivity to end, or even, you know, as much as maybe 2 months or before that, we can start the next succession in our nurseries, right? And they will start being productive, you know, after a period of about 2.5 months, which is the period of growing for the chili plant, right? So the chili plant goes from seed to the point of where it can be harvested first for chilies in about 10 weeks or so, which is 2.5 months, right? And after that, chili again, we've not been able to show it completely, you know, over here, but it will continue to be productive for the next 4 to 6 months even, right? So, right. So what Yogita has just asked me to kind of, you know, emphasize also over here is, please note that over here in each of these cases, not only are we doing the succession, but we are also doing a rotation. So we are making sure that our plant, you know, actually gets replaced by another plant in the pot. And in this way, we will avoid a lot of soil diseases also. We will avoid pest issues also, right? And have better nutrition for the plants, right? But remember, this is one way to look at it. So this is, if you see the title of the slide, it says how succession works in pots, when you're seeing it from the perspective of each pot that makes up your garden, right? There is a little bit of a different way to look at it also, and this is what I'll show you over here. This is how succession works when you want to do the same crop, right? So for example, I think I mentioned earlier spinach, and I said that, you know, if you want to make sure that you have a continuous supply of spinach, you have to work in a slightly different way. So over here we have, you know, spinach happening, not necessarily in the same pot, maybe in separate pots, and that allows us to actually have the plants started even before the pot is empty, correct? In the previous example, just going back to it, we have waited for the pot to become empty and then transplanted into this pot, right? But when you're looking at it from a crops perspective, assuming you've got multiple you know, pots, what you could do is you could start, say, 5 pots of spinach up. They would grow for a period of 2 months and produce for a period of 2 months, which is till the end of August, just as an example. Now, what I would then do is right at the end of May, just like 4 weeks from now, I would start the next round of them so that they would grow till the end of July. And then from August onwards, while my spinach is still producing, but perhaps in the second half when the production is coming down, this one would be building up its production, right? So basically there is overlapping between the different crops over here. So you will see that if you look at the first line, July and August is productivity, then August and September for the second round or second pot. And then in another pot, it's being productive in September and October. And then in October and November. So you have this overlapping happen, which leads to continuity in terms of, what you are getting from your garden. So in a very rough sense, the formula is like this. In the case of palak, the growing period is 2 months. The productive period is 2 months. And the sowing interval, how far apart you should sow your seeds into your nursery, is just 1 month, right? So every month, you should be putting down new palak plants so that you can have continuous productivity going forward, right? So maybe you can think of this as a nursery day, a day. Maybe you pick a Monday or a Friday or some particular day of the week every month when you actually go out there and think about what needs to be planted as a succession. And this is one way to kind of approach it. Okay. So hopefully, I have not completely confused everybody in this regard. If you do have more questions, I can answer that at the end of this session or in the Telegram group, where you're welcome to put down your questions. More or less, you can look at these two different ways, which is why I have, kind of used these slides to show different ways at looking at the problem. You pick any one of these and you can kind of move forward with it and, ensure that you have this kind of continuity. So, once we reach the end of the season, the harvest has happened and you're planning the succession. But before you plant the succession, you need to consider what the condition of your soil is and what nutrients are still available or needed for the next crop. And therefore, it brings us to an important stage with Yogita will demonstrate, which is how to reset your pots at the end of the season, which means basically looking at your soil and bringing it back to the level where it's going to continue to be highly productive, right? So I'll pass this on to Yogita and she will start the demonstration.
So I'm going to show you how to reset a pot, but before I do that, I just want to show you what I have on my table here. For those of you who were there with us when we did the session on microgreens, these are the radishes that I sowed. I'll lean over and sort of show you. They have been harvested just yesterday and they were put in a this glass box with a cover and put in the fridge, and they look super fresh. They're spicy to taste. They have a nice zing, so you can put in a salad, in a sandwich, whatever. These are some of the red amaranth. I wouldn't really call this microgreens. They're more like baby greens. If you just see the difference, in the case of the radish, what you see here is literally just the first leaves. These are the little heart-shaped leaves. These are the seed leaves. They're not. This is the real true leaf. The first true leaf has started growing. So I've harvested it at this point, and this is a microgreen. In this case, you can see that, some of them are older. Like you see, this has got about 1, 2, 3, 4 leaves already. And the seed leaves are just here. These are the, so had I harvested it when only this much was there, I don't know if it's clearly visible, just these two, then it would be a microgreen. But at this point, it's like a baby green, very tender. Just had it for a salad and for lunch. My daughter assembled it for us. And very, very nice, crunchy to taste. That is one thing. Another thing is I have a little vase here. I don't usually buy cut flowers, but I often harvest stuff from the garden and I put it in these jars with a little bit of water. It stays pretty good for about a day or so. Stays fresh. So if I harvest it today and there's a certain amount that I've used, I just keep it lying around the kitchen, and then this becomes something that I will cook. And you can have like a bouquet of herbs. I've got some peppermint in here. There's palak, there's red bhaji. This is just one way to store it. Another way to store a leafy vegetable harvest is make sure that you put it in a damp cloth, and you don't need to wash it. Once you harvest it, do not wash it. Just take the harvested leaves, put it in the damp cloth, fold it up like a little package, and keep it anywhere in your kitchen that is not under a fan, because if the wet cloth is drying out when it's under a fan, basically it's going to make the leaves wilt. So any, you know, corner of your kitchen where there's no draft and it's not hot, you can store this for up to 2 to 3 days. It remains surprisingly fresh. You do not need a fridge for leafy vegetables, which is something I learned and I was very happy to learn. Okay, I have a few bhindis and a couple of cherry tomatoes here from the garden. We harvested a lot of the cherry tomatoes yesterday, so I don't have more to show. But I'm going to quickly clear the table and show you how to do a pot reset. So I have this pot here. It used to be a tomato, a cherry tomato. The last of the cherry tomatoes, you can see, it's a nice red cherry tomato. A lot of flavor. But this plant is done now. So now the question is, what am I going to plant next in it? And how am I going to do it? This was a tomato, so I will certainly not plant something from the same family. That means no brinjal, no chilies, and certainly no tomatoes. Okay, I have an arugula plant here, and I have a basil plant here that's a little small. I'd also like to show you, I'm not using this just now, but after the first session, I had shown you how you can cut slices of tomatoes and grow seedlings out of them. So here you can see there were two slices of a really nice variety of tomato I found in the market, not the usual Roma oval type. But I just put the two slices in, and I must have at least about 20 seedlings in here. Some of them are a little tall and lanky, but by and large, they look pretty healthy. Now, this will become 20 plants of tomatoes either in my garden, or I could share it with neighbors. That's a lot of seed from literally nothing, just a tomato in the kitchen. Okay, so I'm going to now transplant. I think I'll put in the arugula in here. You can see this is the root ball of this plant. It's got some soil in it, so I'll just dust it out. This is the stake that was attached to the plant, because this is a vine and it can sort of fall, so it gives it support. I've taken that out. What you see on top here is the mulch. So I'm going to remove the mulch out just to see what's the condition of the soil inside. I can see that the level of the soil in the pot has gone down a bit. In some places, I can see that there is a little bit of compaction. So either you can use what we have, a garden trowel. I forgot to get it for myself. But usually the soil is still so soft, I can just use my fingers and it just comes apart. So I really don't need tools here. I often don't use a lot of the tools, but so I'm loosening the soil in case there is any compaction. And because this tomato is a heavy feeder, which means it will have taken out quite a bit of nutrients from the soil, I have with me a bag of vermicompost. So I'm going to put in a generous amount of compost. Leafy vegetables love nitrogenous manures like compost, goat manure, vermicompost, whatever. So I'm going to put in maybe 2 handfuls like this in. This is a 10-inch pot. Okay, and I'm going to mix it into the pot itself, so that the level has also come up to where it was for the plant when I would have first prepared this pot. And I'm going to now plonk my arugula into this. So this has been grown separately in a little cup. We did this about maybe 3 weeks ago. This should be 3 weeks old. One step I forgot to do is I forgot to put back the mulch. Okay, this is really a super important step. I would not miss doing this. If you run out of leaves, you can always, you know, get some more from your neighborhood or ask, you know, friends who have a little, maybe a compound around their house. They can give them a bag and ask them to just save it up and, you know, keep it for you. So now the pot is ready to receive the transplant. I'm going to make a little hole in the center and I'm going to scoop out a little bit of the soil because that's going to be replaced with the soil in my transplant here. I'm going to hold this, turn it upside down. I've been asked to show you the root and the whole thing comes out. Now the beauty of this is, if you look here closely, you will see that the roots are undisturbed. They have sort of formed nicely around the cup. And if I was pulling it apart from, say, a tomato thing like this, the roots would be broken. And the plant would suffer shock, as we had explained in our transplanting session. But here, the shock will be minimal to almost none. Now I take this entire plug, if you can call it that, and just gently put it into the pot. Take the soil around it and press it in so that it stands there firmly. It shouldn't be lolling about. I could put back some of the soil that I've taken out. I'm finding that it's sort of moving a little bit, which means that in the breeze, it will move around. I have some more soil here. Maybe just a little bit more around it. And press it down so it's firm on all four sides. And just keep the immediate collar around the plant clear. And that's it. My pot is ready. What I've done is I've removed the old plant. I have loosened up the soil. I have added more nutrients by adding more compost to it. I have mulched it. And I've made a little gap where the plant will go. I have transplanted it in there. And now I will water this. I won't water it on screen just now. But when I water it, I will water it through till the water comes out from the bottom. And the pot is entirely ready for a new crop now. Okay. So now I'm going back to the slides. That's you. Yeah. Back to Karan.
Okay. So, you know, the harvesting we've covered and the resetting pots we've covered, but we thought that in this particular session, while we've so far, you know, largely concentrated on growing vegetables, we thought we'd try and add a little bonus bit about growing fruits, because this is something that certainly didn't occur to us in the early days of growing in balconies and on terraces. And yet, you know, is something that is quite easy to do if you have a little extra space. Most typical balconies that we see in cities are maybe, you know, a little over a meter in terms of width, not very deep. And they could be as much as 4 or 5 meters, you know, in length, right? So these tend to be, they tend to be spaces in which you feel you don't have enough width and space to put in a fruit tree. And that is absolutely true. Therefore, you would continue to focus on vegetables. But if you have a little larger balcony, or if you have a terrace that is open, you know, suddenly it becomes possible to do fruit trees too. So we'll talk a little about growing fruit trees in pots. And, you know, we found it very rewarding. And the funny thing is, we started doing this because we didn't have garden space, right? So we were like, oh, we don't have a garden. But, you know, what if we just get fruit trees started? And, you know, even if we move around, we can take them with us. And it sort of made a lot of sense to us. So we'll talk a little bit about which fruit trees you can grow. Now, this is an example of a pomegranate tree. It's growing in Bombay. This is on Yogita's mum's terrace. And they have several fruit trees in their pots. These pots are about 2 foot pots. That's 24 inches. Typically, when we talk about pot sizes, it means they're 24 inches wide at the mouth. So it's a fairly large pot. It's not easy for one person to move it around. But it is something that, as you can see, is very productive. You can see at least a half dozen fruits right here in the frame and more on the way. Each of the flowers that you see will also, convert into a fruit, right? So Pomegranate is one example of something that you can grow and that is really productive. Guava is another thing that we quite enjoy growing, and the reason for that is quite like pomegranate. This is not something that fruits only once in a year. It actually produces fruits at different points of the year, as much as maybe three different rounds through the year. So if you like guavas, this is a very productive thing to grow. And, you know, it actually gets to the point of fruiting pretty fast. So I think we've got some fruit trees which are not even, I mean, grafts that we've planted into pots and which are producing fruit as little as a year later on. Right. And it could be, you know, something that you enjoy. The fruits will be full sized fruits. They will not be baby fruits because it's in a pot or a smaller or a younger plant. It's just that the quantity of fruit that you will have will be less than a mature tree. These plants can continue to stay in these pots for several years. The pomegranate tree, for example, I think has been more than 10, 15 years in those pots. Am I correct on that? Yeah, and Yogita's folks actually have a kumquat tree that was, you know, as old as her dad. So it spent 60 years, that's 60 years in a pot. I'm not suggesting that should happen for every tree, but, you know, you can get a fair bit of productivity, certainly. And of course, in the case of the kumquat, it moved from smaller pots to bigger pots over time. But you could just pick a 20-inch pot, which we feel is a good intermediate size, and you could grow it for many, many years in that. Figs, surprisingly productive. So I know you look at the plant and you look at it and say that, hey, you know what it is? It looks like a fairly scrawny plant, just a thin stem and two branches. But if you just count up the number of figs you have over there, you'll see that it's a couple of dozen at least. This is a pot that, again, is less than a year, you know, in the pot, a plant that is less than a year in the pot, and it's already being productive for us. So we, you know, it's a surprising kind of fruit, not a very common fruit also for many of us, but extremely delicious and can grow in pots very productively. Citrus is something that grows very well. I had mentioned kumquats earlier, but depending on your climate, it could be, you know, limes, certainly lemons, those can grow very well. Pomelos can grow very well also, especially if your, you know, weather is on the warmer side, on the more tropical side. So these are fruits you can grow and they can be fairly productive. You know, a couple of pots of this is all you probably need for your family. Chiku, like guava, produces virtually three times in a year. If you like chiku, I mean, it can be super productive. This particular plant is something we have just outside our store. It has now spent 5 years in a pot. Coincidentally, we planted this in one of our workshops, which was maybe, you know, 5 years ago, and we kind of demonstrated how to plant it in this pot, and we just left it there. And it's now, I would say, almost 7 feet tall. Like, it's taller than a 6-foot person, like it's taller than I am, and it's pretty wide too. So it requires a lot of space because it's about 4 feet across also. But at the same time, is fairly productive. You will at any point in time probably see about 25, 30 fruits in different stages of production on this plant. Right. Custard apple is another one that grows well in pots and is productive. It can give you, you know, several fruits. And if that's something you enjoy eating, why not, you know, have it growing in your own garden? For many of these things, I would suggest, depending on your preferences, don't plant just one tree of a type. Ideally, if you really like the fruit and you picked it, I would say two pots. Right. So you may have room only for four pots, then pick two sort of fruits that you enjoy and just have two pots each. That's what I would do, really. Star fruit is something that is very common and also, you know, popular in Goa. This is a pot that we, less than 1.5 years old again, I think, and it is very productive. You will notice that in each of these pots, we have very heavy mulch. So we grow exactly like we grow the vegetables. We mulch our pots. The soil mix is also very similar. It's 50% soil, 25% vermicompost, 25% cocoa soil, and with a sprinkle of rock phosphate. That's largely the medium that we use to grow. And of course, we use a lot of Panchagavya and Jeevamrut in order to, you know, water the soil from time to time or give it a foliar spray. And this really helps the fruiting results that we experience. This is mango. Now, mango, for most of us, is a sentimental journey in itself. I'm sure most of you are going out looking for yours this summer. But here is something that is growing in, again, in Yogita's folks' garden in Bombay. And this is now, I think, more than 10 years, this tree, if I remember correctly. And I would like to point out, though, you can see about 4 fruit over there and another, you know, it can get up to 10, 15 fruit in a season. The one thing about mango is it's only going to produce once in the year. So it is, in a sense, not as productive as many of the other trees. The other thing is that in this particular case, while it's worked well with a dwarf variety, this is Amrapali. We haven't yet reached the point where the pots where we are experimenting with more, you know, with larger tree varieties have fruited. So we'll probably know in about a year. I think several of them will be close to ready for fruiting, and then we can kind of confirm that. But the dwarf variety like Amrapali certainly, you know, is fairly productive. You can see a whole bunch of flowers over there also, some of which will convert into fruits. Pineapple is something that, you know, grows in the shade. We've talked about it. For those of you who don't have sunny balconies, this is certainly something that you can plant in pots, you know, or leave them in, or use up shaded parts of your balconies to grow. The idea is to use usually a 14-inch pot and to put one plant per pot. Now, most of the time, a good way to do it, especially in an apartment, if you don't have access to pineapple suckers from a nursery, is to actually use what is the crown or the head of your pineapple. So if you bought a pineapple and it's been very tasty, you just take off the top or the head, you know, of it, and you plant it into the soil. And it will take a little longer than a sucker would have taken to produce, but it will produce, and maybe in a couple of years or so you have pineapples, right? So just remember, it's usually one pineapple per plant, and you would usually need to give up that space for a longer period of time, which is a couple of years before you would have that. Of course, as we know, it also grows in the ground. Watermelon is another thing that you can grow. You will need a little bit of a mato or sort of a, you know, a structure to hold the plants, a trellis to hold the plants, since that tends to be a climber. But you can have fruit. It starts out as a small fruit and it continues to grow in size, and over a period of time comes to the size of the watermelon that we are used to consuming. Of course, the size and also appearance varies according to the variety that you are growing, right? So passion fruit is, in many senses, a wonder. Now, if you will see this particular case, this was a garden where we set up and we didn't want to plant it in the soil. So what we did is we took several pots. You can see these, you know, close to about 10 pots. And you can see there are about three of them, a couple of them close to each other where the red arrow is pointing. And essentially, this whole vine is growing out of the pots. It's not in the soil. And I suspect you can see at least 30 fruit kind of indifferent, you know, close to getting closer to maturity over here. It has been climbed onto this fence. You can, in a similar way, climb it onto a grill or, you know, in your window, your balcony window, or, you know, use a net on the grill to allow this to climb, and it would be extremely productive. It does tend to take up, grow very fast, vigorously, and take up a lot of space. So just make sure that it's not in a situation where it's blocking out the light for the rest of your plants. But it's a great thing to grow, for example, on a wall or a fence downstairs, because it will just spread to wherever the sun is and give you lots and lots of food. So as you would have seen, you know, it makes a lot of sense to grow fruits if you have a little extra space. If you're somebody who actually stays in a rented place, it's good because you can actually move these things along with you. In many cases, you can also, like, for people who have actual gardens, I often suggest to people, you know, why don't you grow it in a pot for a few seasons? And if you really like the plant, then put it into the soil in your garden, because, you know, that is something that literally it's your legacy to your kids. And, you know, if it's a really good tasting variety, you will want to retain it, you know, for a long time and through your life, right? What I'll do now, however, is, you know, shift to the part about how you actually plant in a pot. And Yogita is going to demonstrate this for us. It's going to be reasonably familiar to you since we've talked about planting vegetables, but I think there are some details that is important to note, and Yogita will kind of point these out to you, right? So over to Yogita.
Before I start showing how to transplant, so I have with me here a chiku. This is it's a graft. Now I'll quickly touch upon what is a graft, what is an air layer, what is a seedling or a sapling. For some fruit, you may find that people put in like avocados. People will start an avocado seed and it will grow, it will germinate and it will put out roots, but roots and a shoot and everything. But the thing is that many of the fruit trees, when they are grown, there are two things. When they are grown from seed, number one, you cannot be 100% sure that the same variety will express itself. Now, that's the whole thing about the genetics of a plant, and I won't explain that. You can read up about it if you are interested in it, and it is extremely interesting. The seed will then produce something that's a little different, or it can produce, very likely. So very often, fruit trees are not propagated by seed, but they are propagated in ways like in ways that are called air layering or grafting. A graft is basically where you see, this is a very nice plant. I love the fruit of it. I want to replicate it. It's like you can say a genetic clone. So you'll take a cutting from the tree you like, and you will fix it onto what's called a rootstock of another plant that is usually of the same family. It will be such that it will be either resistant to disease in that area, or it will just be a sturdy rootstock onto which your main plant that you're interested in this case is chiku, and most likely the rootstock here, and I don't know if it's clearly visible, I can come a little closer, maybe you can't see it, but you can see the darker stem here. This is the main chiku plant, and the lighter stem here is that of a kidney. It's a kidney, basically what the chiku grafted on. So this will be ready to produce. This is a 1-year-old graft. I will put it into this tree, into this pot, and it will be ready to produce in another year itself. If I was to plant chiku by seed, it will take at least 5 to 7 years. Limes, lemons also at least 5 to 7 years. Avocados perhaps 10 to 12 years. So trying to grow something from seed is not advisable simply because it takes too long and you cannot be 100% sure that you will get the same plant that you want. An air layer is basically where you take a branch and you take a portion of the stem and you treat it in such a way that it starts growing roots from that stem itself. Then you disconnect that, it's a complete plant in itself, and then you plant it in your pot and you have another plant that will again be ready to produce in about a year or so. So basically I'm saying that if you want to grow fruiting trees, do not go for seedlings. I would not go for seedlings. I would much prefer a graft or an air layer, and do ask your nursery when you go to buy whether it is an air layer or not. Now, how do you transplant a fruiting tree? I have a much larger pot here. This is it is a 14-inch pot actually. This is also not a very large tree. If this was a larger tree, I would have taken the next size, like an 18-inch pot or so. I have prepared partially, like we have done in the past, where I showed you that you put stones at the bottom, you fill it up to, about maybe I filled it 3/4 with soil. Now, what I'm going to do is I'm going to place this in the pot and just see where the level of the soil in the bag comes to. I want the level over here to be pretty much the level. Once I take it out of the plastic bag, it should basically be at the top level of this pot. So I think I can take out a little more soil. It's a little higher than I would like. Now, what I have done is this. Is that visible?
Not really.
It's dark in there, right? So anyway, so I have, you can just imagine the pot is full 3/4 of the way. I have made a little depression in the center. Now with a pair of scissors, I'm going to cut this up. And expose what is called the root ball of the plant. Okay. You can see some of these are the chiku roots. This is a nice clay root ball. Yeah, the color of the soil is very different. You can tell from the color that I have here, which is clearly visible, that this is darker, this is lighter because it's clay. I'm going to again place it in here and see that this level matches up with the top level. It still needs to go in a bit, and that means about right. So I'll place it right in the center of the pot. Sometimes you may end up with a graft or a plant that's slightly crooked. So you can always choose to plant the root ball, you know, crooked to adjust for the fact that the tree has grown crookedly, so that eventually what you have is an upright growing plant. As I put this in, I'm just going to loosen out the bottom so that it gives a little room.
Just to add to what Yogita is saying, it's what you should also check the graft joint. Sometimes there's still a plastic piece over there, and Yogita will talk about why it's important to deal with that.
Okay. So now I have also with my fingers, generally I'm just loosening the top. And once this is done, I bring the soil close up. The root ball is still sticking out. I am now going to add more soil. Do this. And remember, the amount that was under the soil when it was in the bag is pretty much the level at which I want it. I will not, for example, bring the soil up to here. My graft line is somewhere here. So I'm going to basically keep this as I can still add a little more space in the pot. So maybe a couple of handfuls more. Spread it around. A little more on this side here. And that is more or less it. And again, I will press it down firmly. Never do this pressing after you have watered the soil. Because if you do that, you will compact all the air spaces and that will not be good for the roots. They cannot breathe. You do this, you know, pressing down and making it firm while the soil is still dry. And I think this is more or less done. My last, final and most important step is the mulch. So I have these collected from my neighbor's garden, and I cover this up with mulch, dry leaf, and you know, you always keep the collar around the plant here, maybe like an inch or so. Just make sure that the mulch is not touching the stem, sort of like a ring around the plant, and that's it. Now I'll water it deeply. Karan mentioned about this tag, he mentioned that this should be taken out as a reminder. Yes. So this should come off. This basically says that this is a chiku. So I will take this off. Now, why would I take that off? Or, you know, where they make the graft, they actually tie it up with plastic so that it stays together and moisture doesn't get in while it's sort of moving together. If that remains, it's like a tight tie around the neck of the plant. And the plant is going to continue to grow, but that is going to really constrict it at that point. And the plant will end up with a funny shape. It will have a strange bump in the middle, a strange constriction, and that's not healthy for the plant. So make sure anything over here, if there are signs, they're all removed. And that's it. We've done the chiku plant in a pot. This is a 14-inch pot. This plant will now, I think, stay here for at least the next 18 months. I don't need to up the size. But eventually, over time, as the plant grows in size, so will the root ball. Maybe in 18 months or 2 years, I will graduate to either an 18-inch pot or a 20-inch pot, so that then I have another long run of maybe another 2 years or so. And a 24-inch pot is pretty big, and it can accommodate, like you saw the photo that Karan showed, the large 5-year-old plant. I would not put chiku in a pot larger than 24 inches. It really doesn't need it, because you will also be pruning and keeping it at a certain size. So, the next
18
months
for
this plant. Over to you,
Karan. Thanks, Yogita. Okay, so I'll just come back to the presentation that we were watching. And I'll sort of summarize a few of the things that we have covered in this particular segment, which is about growing the fruit trees in pots. So the things that you need to keep in mind are this. Number one, ideally, you know, most of the time I would grow in a 20-inch pot. I would not use a 24-inch pot unless I didn't really have to move it around, because you could pretty much need three people to move a 24-inch pot around. It has such a large volume of soil, and the pot itself is heavy, and the tree, when it would have grown into that, you know, into its over 3-4 years, will also be pretty big and heavy. So it becomes very difficult to move. Avoid the 24-inch pots unless you know that more or less, you know, it's going to be stationary, or unless you feel that you have enough help and it's okay to, you know, move it around. The 20-inch pots, a couple of people can handle it, and yet it has enough space to grow that you could have a plant there for the next 10 years or so, depending on which type of plant. I think I noticed a question somebody was asking about, you know, how come these are big, large trees, they actually grow up being two stories high, and how you were squeezing them into a pot. So that's the beauty of nature. You know, it uses the space that it has. And what kind of happens is that because of the root ball itself constraining the size to, or the extent to which the roots can grow, and because, you know, nature has designed it so that the roots are about the same volume as the upper leaf canopy. So if you have less roots, you will have less branches and less leaves, and it will still be productive. It will still be mature and produce fruit. Okay. One of the things that I want to highlight over here, do not do this if you have a very shaded space. You cannot be growing this in like 2-3 hours of sunlight or 4 hours of sunlight. You need to have a bright, sunny place for all fruit trees. Otherwise, they are not really productive. So, you know, you would find them producing a lot less than you want otherwise. Pick your fruit trees very carefully, by which I mean, make sure you go to somebody who has high quality saplings. You know, maybe your agriculture department, maybe a particular nursery that you know has a reputation for good plants, because you will be investing a lot of time and attention in growing this plant over the years. And, you know, at the end of it, if it's not such great fruit, either in terms of taste or in terms of productivity, then that's not a lot of fun. So I mean, it's not even possible for us to look at a plant and know whether it's a great variety. More or less, it's, you know, the tasting of the fruit that kind of validates that. So just, you know, go to a plant, go to a place where there's a nursery which has a good reputation in terms of quality, and you should find good trees. It's worth spending literally double going to such a nursery rather than getting it from some roadside stall, because the amount of investment of time and other things that you will do is really high for fruit trees over the years. And last thing is to prune your fruit trees regularly. So this is another way in which they do, you know, stay in the pot for a longer period of time. By limiting the canopy size, you are also limiting the root size, the inverse of what I mentioned earlier. And in that way, ensuring that it does not outgrow the pot. Right. So these are things that you need to keep in mind for fruit trees. Of course, I mean, there are 100 other things that can be discussed in this regard, but I think that's all that we have time for today. Just to summarize what we've talked about through this session, I mean, apart from the fruit trees, the first thing is harvesting is pretty simple. Once you know how, it takes a little while to get the hang of it, but hopefully we've given you enough kind of hints and tips on so that you can get it right. The second thing is, don't run out of produce. And the only way to do this is to, you know, plan your successions carefully. It's very, how do you say, it's like a big letdown if, you know, you have a great season and then after that you have nothing. So, you know, it spoils the mood, right? Yeah, it's Yogita saying feast to famine. And that's not the situation we want. Kitchen gardens ideally should be productive right through the year, 12 months of the year. You know, of course, growing different things. Then when you're resetting your pots for the next succession, please add nutrition so that there is healthy growth and large productivity for the next season too. You can grow fruits, as we said, if you have a little extra space and sunlight. This may not be applicable to all of you, but for those who can, I think that's a great way to go. And it adds to diversity both to your garden and to the produce that you're getting from it, right? So this brings us to the end of the presentation section of this session. You know, we wish you the best since this is the last season and we, you know, last session, and we hope that you have great results in the garden. In case there is something you would like to know from us, the best place to do this is to join the Telegram group that we've created with HasGeek. It's called Anyone Can Grow. And basically, it's the link that you can use to join it is t.me/anyonecangrow with no spaces. You can see the link sort of mentioned over there. You can also, of course, email us at info@greenessentials.in if you'd like to reach us for something else. But in terms of the group itself, I think it's a place where you can find, we can answer your questions. You can even share your pictures as you see over here. And it's fairly easy to use. If you're familiar with WhatsApp, it's not really very different to use. So please do join us there and you know, ask any questions over the next few weeks also. We'll try to answer them as soon as possible. It may be that you ask in the morning and we only get back to you in the evening because we are tied up with stuff, but we will come back to your questions over there, right? What I'm going to do is just going to ask Amok to do something that I forgot to ask him to do at the beginning of a session. He's going to run a couple of polls for us. So Amok, if we can run these polls, I'd appreciate it if you can, you know, give us feedback over here in terms of how you felt about this session. Okay. It looks like we've generally had people get at least somewhat confident. So that's a good thing. Amok, I think we have another poll. So in this case, we'd like to know how you describe yourself as a kitchen gardener. Do you think you're a beginner, or do you have some experience maybe in ornamental gardening but not so much in kitchen gardening, and therefore a lot of this is familiar to you? Okay, so Amog, we'll do the other ones after the question and answer session. We'll sort of move on to that. So just a reminder, I know that many of you would have already done this, but if you want to put in your questions, if you are watching this on YouTube, you can add it to the comments and we will try and address them. If you're, you know, viewing this through Zoom, then basically you can just go to your Q&A or chat window and you can ask your questions there, right? Okay, so I'll just request Anish perhaps to help us with this and kind of bring us the questions so that we can answer them.
Thanks, Karan. Thanks, Yogita. That was again a very informative session today. We have a few questions on harvesting. We have a few questions on fruit trees, and we have a few questions on the various kinds of charts, especially like the ones you showed today. So I'll start off with the questions on harvesting. We have a question from Anila. She had started growing broccoli in the month of December. And she ended up getting flowers instead of getting broccoli heads. So she wants to know what went wrong. There's also a question from Sangeeta. She had planted carrots, and when she harvested it, they were pale and very hard. So she doesn't know what went wrong there. Yeah.
Okay. So a little bit of information I'm missing in that regard, which is that, you know, where they were growing. But let me answer the question. I think it will make it clear for them also. So broccoli and carrot both are winter crops, first of all. So in the case of the broccoli, you would typically want to plant closer to October. And the reason for this is broccoli needs cool weather to sort of form the heads, right? So I am guessing that when she got the flowers would have been closer to February, perhaps, and or maybe even early March. And what happens at that time, the flowers don't convert into a nice large, you know, head with the broccoli simply because the cool weather is not there. So what's interesting about broccoli is it doesn't mind when it's if it's warmer while the plant is growing. But at the point at which it needs to produce the flower, it needs to have cool weather. Right. So this is true for broccoli. It's also true for cauliflower. And if you want to form the nice solid head of a cabbage, like the closed head of a cabbage, then this is also true for cabbage. So that's something you want to keep in mind. Now coming, sorry, Yogita wants to actually chime in with something.
I'll add something to the broccoli question. It depends what variety. So there are varieties of broccoli that produce one single large head, and then there are varieties that produce several smaller florets. Now, it may have been that you got several florets clustered and you may have thought that that's a bunch of flowers. I don't know. If you have a photo, do share it with us. But just keep in mind that there are different varieties. So you may have got several tiny florets and not the big one head of broccoli that we are used to seeing in the market. So was that the case, or maybe you can just get back to us on that?
So yeah, that's a good thing. So for example, you can consider that for iceberg lettuce, which a lot of people want to grow. Now it comes in two variants. One is a heading variety and one is a loose leaf variety. So sometimes if you that's what you've been eating from the markets where typically we see the heading variety, you may not realize that, you know, this is just a different variety. So that's one kind of issue. In the case of the carrots, it sounds to me like they were probably too old, but I'm not sure. Usually the carrots, as Yogita said, would be ready about four months after they've been sown. Also, again, if you have planted late, carrots need cool weather in order to grow into nice, juicy carrots. Now, if this ended up, you know, kind of happening a little late, then the carrot is usually very stunted, not as big, and certainly it will not be as sweet and juicy also. Right. So the other thing that you can experience with carrots is that if you grow carrots in very clay soil, which is very compacted, then they don't do very well. What they need is looser soil and almost sandy soil. They seem to do much better in that. So there's multiple reasons why the carrots might have failed. Maybe if you can sort of ask this question in the Telegram group and maybe provide us with photos or tell us when you had sown them, we would be able to answer it even better.
Okay, we have another question on harvest. Kora asks, how do you know what is the best time to harvest galangal and turmeric?
So, galangal and turmeric are both from the same family, that is the ginger family. These are underground rhizomes, that's the technical word. They look like roots, but they are not the roots. They are these underground rhizomes that we usually grow these plants for. Now, typically they take a minimum of 6 months, and something like haldi can actually be left in the ground for over a year and a half before you harvest it. So, how to know when they are ready? Pull out a plant. If you have just one single plant, then you can, again, poke around and see whether the rhizome has developed. If you're growing it in a pot, for example, then you will find that the tops of the plant will start withering after about 6 months or so, and they'll become brown and they'll dry out. And that's because the pot has pretty much become root bound. It's really full of these rhizomes. You empty out the whole pot once the plant is dead. You empty out the pot and you remove the rhizomes that you want to consume. And you can always save one or two and put them back in another pot with fresh soil, or in the same pot with fresh soil. And you can continue the cycle of growth. So you harvest what you need and you put back to grow what you can spare. And I would say for galangal and ginger, at least 6 months. For haldi, I would say the longer you wait, the thicker and bigger the rhizomes become. Haldi can go on for up to a year and more.
So I would just add to that quite often the indicator is when the plant dries up and, you know, when it kind of falls over, that's when you know that it has reached one end of the cycle in that sense, right? So that's when it's a good idea to check and kind of make sure that you harvest the plant.
Okay, so moving on to questions on fruit trees. There's a question from Pooja Seth. She asks if there are any disadvantages to grafting trees, fruit trees, into pots. And there's another question from Anila. She had tried growing a grapevine in a pot which completely dried up. She wants to know what went wrong.
Okay, so first of all, you know, the graft trees. Now, a lot of the differences are really philosophical. Grafts, like it or not, grafts are the most popular kind of way of propagating right now. And quite often with seedlings, I mean, it's sort of the best way for you to be certain you've got a good plant. With seedlings, as Yogita said, it can be a hit or miss depending on the type of plant we are talking about. Most of what is called the nursery industry now produces grafts, and even agriculture uses grafts, right? So is it possible to get seedlings that are wonderful? Absolutely, it's possible. But if you look at it in terms of your odds in terms of that, I think grafting tends to provide a better thing. The second thing is that the grafting means that your plants will be productive much quicker. And, you know, in farming, that's what people want. And, you know, that's why that is chosen. And quite often, at least from what we've seen, a lot of people even wanting to grow at home want it to be productive quickly rather than just waiting for years and years on end. Right. So I would say that is the reason why grafts are the sort of best choice. There is one other way to do it, which unfortunately we can't get into in the amount of time we have. There is another form of propagation called air layering. Yeah, sorry. Just slipped out of my mind for a second. So air layering is a way where almost anybody who has a good tree at home can actually take one of the, you know, branches, mature branches, and produce a rooted plant out of that. So it's sort of, again, a clone or like a child of a mature tree, which is why it will give you the same benefits of actually being very productive quickly. At the same time, it will be with roots and you can kind of grow it over there. One thing that may not be equally effective in this method is, as Yogita said, sometimes the rootstocks are chosen because they are extremely hardy and disease resistant in a grafted plant. Right. So sometimes it may be that those tend to be easier to grow than this plant which you've produced from an air layer. And therefore, like, it comes down to your choice. Like, we often do air layers from our grafted plants and it works very well. But also we grow a lot of grafted plants and we are fine with them too. They may not be productive for nearly the period of time a seedling plant is, but as I said, your chances of being happy with the results are and achieving results earlier are much better.
There was a second question on growing a grapevine in a pot.
So now again, I'm not sure where she's growing the grapevine in a pot. For example, we made a trip to Bangalore, I think last year. Oh, Coimbatore, sorry, last year. And we picked up a few grape plants from there just to kind of experiment with it, even though we knew that in Goa the climate is far from ideal for growing grapes, right? So we have these things growing. They don't look super healthy in that sense. They're doing decently, but I wouldn't say that they look super healthy, and they haven't produced red yet, right? And the reason for that is largely, in our opinion, climatic. It really doesn't have much to do with it. So basically, a couple of years, two and a half years is the time that it takes for grapes to get productive. The problem that she's facing could be either because, number one, the climate isn't right. Number two, it's not long enough since she originally planted them, and the plants aren't growing very healthy.
Okay.
One more thing I'd just like to add is, sorry to cut you off, is that the grapes also seem to be susceptible to, fungal issues, which is what I was saying when climatic conditions are not ideal.
Okay. We have a question. I don't know if this is directly about what you were talking about just now, air layering. We have someone asking if we can grow a Mankurat mango tree from a branch of another tree without grafting. This is like to directly plant it into the soil instead of grafting it onto another.
The question is, you can make an air layer out of a mankura, very much, that's very possible. It would take about a month.
Possible to plant it directly into the soil instead of grafting.
So, in an air layer...
Sorry, I'll just cut in there for a minute. Basically, an air layer means you take a branch and you treat it in a particular way where there is root formed right at that place where you do the air layer on the branch, right? So, after you detach it from the parent plant, you would actually be sowing it directly into the soil without grafting. So it is an alternative way of propagation compared to grafting. Correct? So I think that answers the question that he was asking about. Yeah. And basically, we'll move on to the next one.
So I think we've covered most of it on harvesting and fruit trees. We have a question from Kora. He's been growing bush peppers in a pot, and he says that to grow the bush peppers, the peppers have to be plucked off to get to make it grow bushier. Is that what you have to follow to sort of get a healthy bush pepper plant?
No, not necessarily. The plant itself, if the soil is nutritious, will produce a lot of little branches, and on those branches, the little peppercorns will come. So make sure you are giving your soil enough nutrition, and it is not a very rapidly growing plant. It will take a couple of seasons, I would say, for it to become a really bushy plant. It will produce, I think a bush pepper can produce within a year's time, and you harvest the peppercorns, as many as you get, and you keep looking after the plant. It will multiply in the amount of produce you get from it, or the amount of peppercorns you get from it. So, there is no such thing that I'm aware where you have to break the peppercorns for it to produce more.
Okay, got it. The final set of questions are regarding resources and charts that describe the seasonality, the geography, and the harvest timings of various plants. Are there any resources that people can download?
Right. So what we'll do is that we'll put up the charts which we already have ready, which is for the coastal parts of India immediately. Give us a little time. We've actually been very tied up between the webinars and other things over these last few weeks, and we haven't gotten around to making the ones for other cities. So I think as a one of the outcomes that we what we plan to do is that we plan to do charts for at least 10 to 15 different cities. It'll take us a little time to do, but we will share these on the Telegram group. So we'll make sure that we share the ones for the coastal cities. So Bombay, Chennai, Goa, you know, even Kerala, all of these places can use these chart immediately. The Bangalore charts and say for Delhi and places like that will be a little different, and it'll just take us maybe a week or so to kind of get done with those.
Yeah, sounds good. For our viewers who are not willing to wait for that long, please join the Telegram group and ask whatever doubts you have. And I'm sure Karan and Yogita will get back to you in a day's time or so.
Yes.
That brings us to the end of the Q&A session today. I think we have a couple more polls to run. And I hand it over to Karan.
Okay. So I'll ask Amog to kind of run those polls for us to begin with. And I'd really appreciate it if you can give me responses on these questions. I hope all of you have found these sessions useful, because that's really the intention we did them with. And I hope that it leaves you feeling more confident. Several of you have said that that is the case about growing. We would like to see this engagement continue. I think we are going to take a pause for a couple of weeks, But after that, we are planning sessions related to composting. For example, a lot of us have talked about, you know, where do I get compost in the current situation and does that hamper my growing? And as we've said, you know, you should be able to compost at home. So we'll plan a couple of sessions around that just after a break of a couple of weeks while we catch up and prepare these charts. And in the meantime, please, you know, stay in touch with the Telegram groups. Just repeating the link over here for you. It's t.me/anyonecangrow without any spaces. I think it's a much more useful environment in which to do it. Okay, so if you can also give us your feedback on the session itself. For those of you who may be seeing it on YouTube, we'll try sending you a separate kind of form where you can rate us. For those who are, you know, viewing this on Zoom, it's good to know how useful you found it. Please be frank. And we'll try and make sure that we, you know, try and improve these sessions further. Okay, thanks Amok. So moving on, one of the things that a lot of people ask us is about seeds, and while shipping of seeds has been a little challenging, you know, the seed store is something we run to get good seeds to people. These are vegetable seeds. All of them are open pollinated varieties, now hybrids. Many of them are organic seeds. We also try to make sure that, you know, all of these are seeds that have been tried and tested for several years in our garden. So we know and are confident that it will do well even in climatic conditions similar, you know, across the country. So these are things that are easier to grow, that are productive even for beginners. And that's really the goal with the seeds. High germination rate, that is something that is important to us. And varietal purity, that is something that is important to us. Shipping is working well for some cities like Bangalore and Chennai. I think places like Bombay and Delhi is still a little complicated right now and very slow, but hopefully that should change over the next few weeks. Also for those of you who feel you need even more help, you know, we also do this, and you can get in touch with me at the number listed below. Just WhatsApp me or call me and we can try and see if we can help you in a more engaged way over a longer period of time. Thank you all so much for joining us and for having stuck with us. Many of you have stuck with us through these sessions. The videos are available. We'll share the links. The videos of the previous sessions are available. Those links will be shared on the Telegram group also, along with this recording once it's been completed. And great luck with your health, with your, you know, life going forward in this uncertain period, and with your garden. I hope we both of us wish you the very best. And thanks so much, Anish, Amog, Zainab, everybody, for helping us, you know, get this out to folks in what is really, you know, the time of our lives. It's the strangest period, way beyond anything any of us could have anticipated. We are grateful that, you know, for most of us, health has been with us through this period of time. And we hope that, you know, we will find maybe somewhat of a new version of health and happiness over the next few years, even though things seem so uncertain at this time. So thank you so much for joining us, and we will try and remain in touch with you. Look forward to seeing you all again. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye. It was great doing these sessions. Karan actually said most of the things I wanted to say, but a big thanks to everyone at HasGeek who really made this possible. And it's been good fun for us to do this as well. So until we see you again, happy gardening.